friends.
Good morning.
That was kind of half our living.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I can see you, so I know that you're there. There are some continued announcements that we've shared before, but there's a new one. Singers and bell ringers are needed. And there's no requirement to read music. Is that right?
They'll teach you.
And I was assured many years ago that to ring bells you only need to be able to count to four. I don't know if that's accurate. Okay, for the most part. So that means any of us could master that. This afternoon, we have our hymn singing and our high school social, which I hope that you all will come and enjoy a time of fellowship together. The food pantry is still needing some particular items: beets, collards, carrots, and pouches for potatoes. So if you're at the market and you happen to run across those, please pick them up. The United Women in Faith are collecting for school supplies. It's easy, just like it's easy in the grocery store, it's easy when you're at Walmart or Target or wherever you shop to pick up a couple notebooks or a package of pencils, and there's a space in the narthex for that. A reminder again that following the men's breakfast on September 16th, there's going to be an emergency preparedness training from the American Red Cross. Everyone is invited. You don't have to be a man to come to breakfast. Everybody is always welcome. Jerry said he had no announcements, but he did share with me that one of the vendors brought boxes of food for our food pantry, one of the farmers market vendors. I think that's worth sharing.
Yes.
So if they can do it, we can do it too. So when you have the opportunity, please do it. I'll remind you when we get close to prayer time, we celebrated Lex Barker's birthday and celebration of his life yesterday. It would have been 87. I'll give you a little bit of Lex trivia. I did not know his name was Lawrence. Did y'all know his name was Lawrence? Please say no. So he went by Lex because when he was introduced to Mary, he told her his name was Lex Barker from the Tarzan TV program. So that's worth celebrating right there. But we celebrated his life, his family gathered together last night to greet people, and so I'll ask for continued prayers for that family. Is anybody else coming up? Our neighbor across the way, according to Facebook, is doing pretty well. Did they take out the test tube?
I haven't seen an update.
Okay, she hasn't seen an update. It didn't occur to me to look to Facebook, but the church has been posting updates on his health. So if you have access to Facebook and you're curious, you can just look up Hilton Baptist and find out how the pastor is doing. Continued prayers will be welcome, as they will for Phyllis and all of the people that we have on our prayer list. Well, if there are no more announcements, I turn it over to John.
Thank you.
grace. Amen.
Good morning. Our scheduled lay reader this morning, Mayla Swinford, has injured her knee and leg, so she wasn't able to be here. So I will be substituting for Mayla. Our Old Testament lesson is from Exodus. It is chapter 1, verse 8, through chapter 2, verse 10. Now a new king arose over Egypt who did not know Joseph. He said to his people, "Look, the Israelite people are more numerous and more powerful than we. Come, let us deal shrewdly with them. Our day will increase, and in the event of war, join our enemies and fight against us and escape from the land." Therefore, they set taskmasters over them to oppress them with forced labor. They built supply cities, Pithom and Ramesses for the Pharaoh. But the more they were oppressed, the more they multiplied and spread. So the Egyptians came to dread the Israelites. The Egyptians subjected the Israelites to hard servitude and made their lives bitter with hard servitude in mortar and bricks and every kind of field labor. They were ruthless in all tasks that they imposed on men. The king of Egypt said to the Hebrew midwives, one of whom was named Shifra and the other Pua, "When you act as midwives to the Hebrew women and see them on the birth stool, if it is a son, kill him. But if it is a daughter, she shall live." But the midwives feared God. They did not do as the king of Egypt commanded them, but they let the boys live. So the king of Egypt summoned the midwives and said to them, "Why have you not done this, and a hand have allowed the boys to live?" The midwives said to Pharaoh, "Because the Hebrew women are not like the Egyptian women, for they are vigorous and give birth before the midwife comes to them." So God dealt well with the midwives, and the people multiplied and became very strong. And because the midwives feared God, he gave them families. Then Pharaoh commanded all his people, "Every son that is born to the Hebrews, you shall throw into the Nile, but you shall let every daughter live." Now a man from the house of Levi went and married a Levite woman. The woman conceived and bore a son, and when she saw that he was a fine baby, she hid him 3 months. When she could hide him no longer, she got a papyrus basket for him and plastered it with bitum and pitch. She put the child in it and placed it among the reeds on the bank of the river. His sister stood at a distance to see what would happen to him. The daughter of Pharaoh came down to bathe at the river, while her attendants walked beside the river. She saw the basket among the reeds and sent her maid to bring it. When she opened it, she saw the child. He was crying, and she took pity on him. "This must be one of the Hebrew children," she said. Then his sister said to Pharaoh's daughter, "Shall I go and get you a nurse from the Hebrew woman to nurse the child for you?" Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Yes." So the girl went and called the child's mother. Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Take this child and nurse it for me, and I will give you your wages." So the woman took the child and nursed it. When the child grew up, she brought him to Pharaoh's daughter, and he became her son. She named him Moses because she said, "I drew him out." Our psalter this morning is Psalm 124. It is responsive, and it is number 846.
Then the raging waters would have gone over us.
Blessed be the Lord, who has not given us as prey to their teeth.
We have escaped as a bird from the snare of the fowls.
The snare is broken, and we have escaped.
Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth.
For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of yourself more highly than you ought to, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body we have many members, and not all of the members have the same function. So we, who are many, are one another in Christ, and individually we are members of one another. We have gifts that differ according to grace given to us. Prophecy in proportion to faith. Ministry in ministering. The teacher in teaching. The encourager in encouragement. The giver in sincerity. The leader in diligence. The compassionate in cheerfulness.
Thank you. I invite you to stand as you are able for reading the gospel. It comes from Matthew this day, chapter 16, verses 13 through 20. Now Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi. He asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, but others Elijah, and still others Jeremiah, one of the prophets." He said to them, "Who do you say that I am?" Then Simon Peter answered him, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah. For flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church. And the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." And he sternly ordered the disciples not to tell anyone he was the Messiah. The word of God for us, the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. So I've had all week to think about the question, "Who do you say that I am?" But I am now going to play stump the congregation and ask you, "Who do you say Jesus is?" What if you had to explain to someone who had never heard the name Jesus before who he is? Could you, like Peter, say he is the Messiah, the living God? He is the one we've been waiting for to redeem all of Israel. That sounds complicated, doesn't it? So who do you say Jesus is? We, every week, use an affirmation of faith. And I purposely do not use the same one every week. So that we have a variety of expressions of who we say this Jesus is to us. Now, if I had asked this question when you were a child, you would have a different answer than perhaps you have today, because your relationship and your experience with Jesus has changed. I could ask you today, and in 10 years ask you again, and it may not be the same. But I thought long and hard how I would answer this question. And I believe I would say, Jesus is the very representation of God's love and forgiveness for all of creation and all of humanity. Now, with those few words, I've taken out the virgin birth, I've taken out he died, he came back, all of those things that we affirm are true. And I could, as you know, get really wordy and draw this out. But at the essence for me, Jesus is God's love in this world, meant for all of us, not just for a few, but for all of us. Today, when we get to the affirmation of faith, you'll see that it is written by a pastor, and it doesn't sound anything like the ones we use on the typical Sunday. We've used it before. I've presented it before you. But who do you say I am? Peter got the answer right for now. Because, you know, when we read next week's scripture, he says, if you have to suffer and die to be the Messiah, then let it not be. And Jesus says to him, get behind me, Satan. So Peter, for this moment, has it right. How would your answer relate to your living? I read an interesting article by another pastor, a Lutheran pastor, who said that this living into our affirmation of faith, what we believe, and who we believe Jesus is, plays itself out in the way we live. That makes sense, right? If you believe Jesus is God, then you're going to live as though Jesus is God. If you believe Jesus was just a good teacher, or he was a prophet who told the truth about God, you would live differently. But this particular pastor said, none of us get it right all the time, which is true. But we don't intentionally not live into what we believe. Does that make sense? It happens. But we aren't intentionally, he used actually malice of forethought as his description of how we would live intentionally in opposition to what we believe. And I don't think any of us here have ever intentionally lived opposite than our faith in Christ. If God is the love of the world, then I have to be loving the world. If Jesus is the embodiment of forgiveness of sin and salvation, then I have to live as though everybody had the same opportunity for forgiveness and salvation that I do. Everybody. Which gets sticky when you talk about some of the horrendous things that have happened in history. If Jesus really is the way, the truth, and the life as we claim he is, what would day-to-day look like? Would we make our decisions based on that faith, that belief, that gift? Because grace is a gift. How would our lives look different than they do now? Pastor I read an article from said, Jesus went out when people were hungry and fed them. And when they were sick, he healed them. And when they were alone, he sat with them. And if our Lord and Savior can do those things, cannot we? The answer, of course, is yes. You know that already. The answer is yes. Feed the hungry. Sit with those who grieve. visit those who are ill or in prison, do all of the things that Jesus did and set the example for us. Every week, as I said, we do a creed. Is that creed something, especially the Nicene and the Apostles' Creed, something that you have memorized? Here's a second question. Have you internalized it? Has it become the way you live on Monday through Saturday? That's why I change it and give you different words, so that we can think about it differently. Because we now have to be Jesus' representation in the world. We have to be the ones who will offer a healing touch, a listening ear, company, just sitting with someone. We will have to be the ones who feed the hungry and make sure the homeless have someplace safe to sleep. That's how I must have. Because we say we believe in this Jesus of Nazareth as the Messiah, the one who came to save us. And I would add, save us from ourselves at times. So I have homework for you. First, I want you to reread the scripture. And second, I want you to answer the question, who do you say Jesus is? There's no wrong answer to that question. How do you understand Jesus as Messiah in your life? That's the assignment. If you were to explain it, if Eric was here today, how would you tell him about Jesus? And he's heard about Jesus, and he knows about Jesus, and he knows about the Bible. But how would you tell an 8-year-old about Jesus? How would you tell an 8-year-old who never heard of Jesus who he is? So that's homework for you. Aren't you glad you came this morning? Homework. Who do you say Jesus is? And there's no cheating. Don't borrow your answer from your spouse or your neighbor. This is work for you to do. And it's not that complicated, that difficult. If you think about it, you may end up with a paragraph or so of who Jesus is, but it also can be just a couple of simple words. Jesus is love. Jesus is mercy. Jesus is Messiah, which means he came to save us. It's a homework for you all, and a short sermon this morning. Homework. We read this passage in Matthew, and how would you answer it? How you answer it should instruct the way you live this week. It should instruct the way you live every single day, but let's start with this week and see how it goes. And then maybe again next Sunday we'll have to do the same thing. And continue to do it till we get it 100% right. And Wesley said we are moving on to that perfection. We may not see it till we're really, really old and can't see. We're moving on towards the perfection we believe that is alive in Christ, so that our lives might be in closer keeping with the life that he lived and lived and died for us. So who do you say he is? Amen. So So there is not going to be an anthem this morning, but if you come at 4 o'clock this afternoon, you'll get an anthem and then some. I invite you to stand as we affirm our faith together using the words that are printed in your bulletin. We belong to God,
eternal and infinite, creator of all things and all that is to come. We follow Christ, who comes to us from God and reveals God to us. He heals people and transforms lives and calls us to join in his ministry. He was crucified, died, and was raised again by God and reigns over all creation. And he bids us to die and rise with him in the service of healing of the world. We are moved by the Holy Spirit, together with the communion of saints, as members of the body of Christ, God's holy universal church. We are confident in the forgiveness of sins, the power of resurrection, and the reality of eternal life. In all things, it is our desire to follow Christ by the grace of the Holy Spirit for God's glory. Amen.
As you are listening, please find page 593. Here I am, Lord. recovers from her knee leg injury. I'm going to ask for prayers for my Uncle Butch. He is 80. He has fallen and broken his neck. He's in a skilled nursing facility at this time. And so, prayers for him, please. We remember the U.S. Marines that have lost their lives in the last few days. Of course, the people of Hawaii. As we go through these prayers, please feel comfortable enough to speak a word, a name, a circumstance, a situation that we might pray with you. God of all, thank you for hearing these prayers, for the human family with whom we share this world, those closest to us and those whose names we will never know. We give you thanks and ask your help in living into our identity as your children. We share with all creation, the plants and animals we see each day, and the wilderness we have never seen. We give you thanks and ask for help in living into our identity as stewards of your earth. National and international leaders, those whose policies we appreciate, and those with whom we struggle. We give you thanks and ask that you be at the side, guiding them to act in justice and mercy. Joys and concerns that occupy our thoughts today, those we've spoken aloud and those we ponder inwardly. We give you thanks and ask that you be at our side, guiding us to recognize that our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth. Accept and heed all these prayers through Christ Jesus, our Lord. Amen. And as Jesus taught us, now we pray together, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our prayer of thanksgiving is Almighty God, you took a baby from the Nile and used him to lead your people to the promised land. Take our offering and use them for the people in this land and throughout your world. In Jesus' name we pray. I invite you now to stand for our closing hymn, Jesus, the Very Thought of Me, Thee. It's on page 175.
Thank you.
pray for Christ Church. Renew your church, Lord, your people in this land.
Save us from cheap words and self-deception in your service. And in the power of your Spirit, transform us and shape us by your cross. Amen.
Brothers and sisters, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed to live as the body of Christ in the Lord. May the Lord, who made heaven and earth, and Christ, who lived and died for all, and the Spirit, who renews our minds and hearts, abide with you and all God's people, now and forevermore. Amen.